Howard, thank you so much for making yourself available for our Jerome Moross centenary celebration. Let's begin, shall we, just by having a look at how it was really that Jerome Moross became importantly noticed in the early days of his career, the help he had from Aaron Copland, who supported him greatly, an important break and starting point, really, for many of the important successes that he had. Perhaps you'd like to tell us about that.
Well, Aaron Copland seemed to think from a very early age he recognized that Jerome Moross had a gift for the theater and for drama, and I think he recommended him for various jobs that required a theater composer. I believe he probably was responsible for his collaborations with Ruth Page, for instance. Copland had worked with Ruth Page, and Ruth Page was always looking for composers to collaborate with. And I believe it was Copland's recommendation to her that helped secure his commissions with his initial commission with her. So he was something of a protege of Copland's, and Copland especially recognized his ability in these type of theatrical contexts.
Yes, it's interesting, isn't it, that Copland was so taken with Moross in those early days, because actually in Jerome Moross's very early days as a composer, even in his late teens and his early 20s, which I think was around the time that Aaron Copland was finding him a really very interesting young composer, at that time Jerome Moross was very interested in a lot of experimental ideas in both music and theatre, wasn't he?
Well, it was a period of course, experimentation with different approaches to theatrical presentation. Of course, there was the model of Bertolt Brecht and Kurt Weill and the work that they had been doing, and other attempts to use dance and theater and voice in new combinations and with new intentions. The Seven Deadly Sins, I think, must have made a big impact in that respect. For example, and I think you see the influence of Seven Deadly Sins on ballet ballads in particular. But I think Frankie and Johnny is a step toward this type of novel use of singing and dance combined that would lead to ballet ballads.
Yes, you mentioned the Seven Deadly Sins. Jerome Moross mentions that enormously admiringly in one of the interviews we have. Certainly that was an influence, and certainly I absolutely agree with you, all the other elements that you've drawn attention to. At the same time, don't you think that he was nevertheless doing something very new with Frankie and Johnny in many ways? I mean, it's despite being certainly, if you like, a corollary from what had happened before with Weill and the other influences. But I still think it's incredibly new and forward-looking for the time.
Yes, I believe that it has a unique way of approaching these old themes of women in society, of relationships and so forth. I think there's a lot of humor in the score, too. That's a lot of ironic humor. That's interesting. So the score kind of cuts both ways. It tells a serious story, but with a sort of ironic edge. And I think the tone of it also comes out of Brecht a lot as well. I think, of course, Copland is hovering in the background of this piece quite a lot. Copland had written Hear Ye for Ruth Page earlier and has a similar quality to it. I imagine that Moross, given his closeness with Copland, must have looked at the score of Hear Ye and taken some, absorbed some of its lessons. I also wonder about, as far as his relationship with Ruth Page, the precedent of John Alden Carpenter, who had written Skyscrapers and other ballets in the 1920s and had worked with Ruth Page. In fact, Ruth Page had made her her great debut in The Birthday of the Infanta in a ballet of John Alton Carpenter's. And Carpenter was a Chicago composer. The connection with Chicago is another kind of fascinating thing, because Chicago has a certain kind of symbol in America. Brecht draws on this, and Moross will return to Chicago very much in Underworld towards the end of his career, too. And the brutality and the irony and the vulgarity, the garishness, and all these things seem to tie into kind of mythic ideas about Chicago.
I have used the word verismo for the way that Moross portrays these elements so realistically. It's not an appropriate word, but I'm going to indulge and use it again here. Just that element of truth and lifelike quality that he seems to portray in this way, showing the violence, the harshness of life in such a realistic way, but at the same time, it seems to me, something very important, expressing great compassion and pathos, which I feel is such a powerful part of his music. Now, I have a little theory here. I wonder whether you think I'm right or whether I'm dreaming, but although we know that Moross was influenced so much by the American sounds around him, and he is often described as being a composer of Americana. Yes, of course, that's absolutely embedded in the harmonic and rhythmic and melodic characteristics in so much of his music. I have a little theory. I don't know whether you would agree with this, but I feel that the pathos is related, the way he expresses this pathos could be something in his Jewish blood, something that maybe has come from his older ancestry. What do you think? Am I up the spout with that?
Well, personally, I don't really feel that much in Moross's music. I feel that I think the early influence of Ives is a crucial component in this regard, because Ives, although recent scholarship has explored the depths and profundity of his relationship to the European tradition, at the same time, of course, he symbolized a freedom from the European tradition, and I think that was a big influence on Jerome Moross. Ives was a big influence on Jerome Moross as a young person. I think that was one of the lessons that he absorbed from Ives, even though he went on and wrote really very different music from Ives. It's still sort of the spirit of individuality, of independence from European traditions, I think holds pretty strong, in my estimation, in Moross. He also never went to Europe to do that sort of postgraduate study that so many composers in the 1920s did. So whereas in Copland, I think the Americana qualities or the use of folk music is very much framed by certain European neoclassicism, I really don't feel that in Moross. I feel that this is someone who is very, very indigenous to the American experience, both musically and in terms of his themes.
Well, yes, in that respect, for me, when I hear particularly Frankie and Johnny, I think to myself, my goodness me, this is so ahead of its time. It's, in terms of its sentiment, and also its style in many ways, to me, I feel it's almost a precursor of some of the very powerfully anxious music and restless music of Leonard Bernstein in the late 1940s and 1950s.
Well, it's interesting that you mention Bernstein, because John La Touche at one point, was to write the lyrics for Candide. That didn't work out for various reasons. But it's hard to imagine that he wouldn't have known both, that Bernstein wouldn't have known both Ballet Ballads and The Golden Apple, and that played its part in his decision to work with John La Touche on Candide.
Yes, I think so. Absolutely. Now, these Ballet Ballads, they were another remarkably individualistic step forward, and they were a conglomeration, weren't they, of some separate pieces that were put together as this group of entertainments all as one complete evening of entertainment?
Well, they use it's actually four different pieces. One was not performed in the original production on Broadway, is Red Riding Hood Revisited, but they use dancers and singers and musicians in different combinations and in different ways, so that by the time you get to Eccentricities of Davy Crockett, the dancers and singers have sort of become one. In Willie the Weeper, the use is different. Willie the Weeper is quite reminiscent of Seven Deadly Sins, because you have the singer as Willie, and also a dancer playing Willie, and they're sort of alter egos, and one dances and one sings. So that's very, very reminiscent of Anna One and Anna Two in The Seven Deadly Sins. I really can't imagine that they conceived this without knowing something about Seven Deadly Sins. But it's a fantastic stratagem, theatrical stratagem, in giving one that sense of distance, that detachment that Brecht is so famous for. And so they're combining the elements of dance and music and acting in unique works, not to kind of mill them in the kind of along the Wagnerian model, but rather to highlight differences and to allow them to kind of clash, if you will.
And something that I noticed very much when I first heard the ballet ballads, the extraordinary differences between each of the items making out the ballet ballads. Now that's part of Moross's very important characteristic of creating a sound world and a style that relates very directly to the content and characterization of the words and the personalities that he's writing music about.
Well, I think they're very different. There's a lot of musical variety. Suzanne and the Elders goes for a sort of rustic, folk-like quality, kind of almost a faux naivete. Willie the Weeper, which I think is maybe the knockout of the group, uses a boogie-woogie bass as the basis of a theme in variations. And the feeling of it looks ahead musically, stylistically, I think, to a lot of rock and roll, actually, of the 1950s and 1960s. It really has the kind of this driving boogie quality that is really wonderful. And, of course, all of these pieces, like Moross's works in general, stage works in general, like Frankie and Johnny, use classical forms to organize the material. So in this case, you have variation form. And variation form actually pops up quite a lot in his work in terms of structuring his ballets and his theatrical works. He uses variation quite a lot. And then you have something like Red Riding Hood Revisited, that he actually used part of to create this delightful orchestral work, the Variations on a Waltz. And it's in the style of the silly symphonies of the 1930s, which were sort of cartoon repurposing of classical music, with very kind of amusing evocation of classical symphonies of Mozart and Beethoven and Bach, but done very whimsically and in a cartoon fashion. And he taps that particular style, but takes it, I think, to a level that's really quite interesting. And that, you know, I think very few people took the Silly Symphony and worked with that as a musical style to develop something so unique and so delightful as Red Riding Hood. And then you have the Eccentricities of Davy Crockett, which I think is extremely poignant and haunting piece that is full of, again, a folk flavor of a special sort. So there's a lot of musical and theatrical variety in this compilation of one-act operas.
They're also all remarkably clearly and strongly organized, aren't they, theatrically, by which I mean the form Jerome Moross uses, really taut, tight, and dramatically very coherent. He was, wasn't he, a great master of form, classical form, and applied his very strong beliefs in and great skills at classical form. He applied that for all his music.
And the mastery of form very often makes these works, I think, makes the whole more powerful than the sum of its parts. Because you actually, when you get to the end, you really feel like you have taken a voyage, and it emerges as an organic whole, which you don't necessarily will always feel in the theater, which can, you know, so easily break up into parts. So he did use, like Alban Berg did with Wutzeck, which is, I think, maybe hovering in the back as a possible model for the imposition of classical forms onto stage works.
Yes, Wutzeck was a work that I'm sure had a big influence on Moross. He was a very highly informed man and artist who was deeply involved in the music that was around him at the time, as well as music that had been written long before he'd been born. Well-educated, that's not the right sort of word, just extraordinarily informed and involved. And I think that he believed, like Berg did, it's a good analogy you've come up with there, strongly that no matter how new the music was going to be, the form was absolutely vital for its success as expression, be it theatrical expression or symphonic expression. I'm sure that's one of the most important reasons why his music, his work, is so very gripping for the listener. And that brings me to The Golden Apple and this extraordinary wholeness about that work. The subject is a big one, and it's something that evolves with speed and yet brilliant coherence, quite apart from all the other elements of genius in the work. And that's, isn't it, because Moross saw from the very beginning, when he started writing this work, he saw the end. He saw the entire picture, like in all his works, of where he was going. And so it's really frustrating, isn't it, that the original cast recording with all those marvellous artists, which RCA brought out in 1954, that only preserves, I don't think it's even half the original work. Now that's a huge loss.
Especially when you think of the very subject we've been talking about, which is form. The form falls apart when you don't have the entire thing. And then you also have the very important fact that when the show moved, and I really shouldn't call it a show because it's very much an opera, but it feels so much like a vernacular work in America that sometimes we refer to it as a musical or a show, but it is very much an opera. When the opera moved to Broadway, Moross wrote a new ending for it and recycled or reprised one of the earlier songs, which undercuts really the amazing thing about Golden Apple to me is that it tells the story of a man's growth, and it uses the adventures of Odysseus to tell this story. And so he comes to a maturity at the end that is expressed in this wonderful finale. Musically, incidentally, looking, I think, ahead very much to, say, the work of Stephen Sondheim. And for some reason, and I'm not entirely sure what, I think it was felt to be a less commercial ending than reprising this earlier song. They reprise the earlier song, and so we don't get an opportunity to actually see the growth, which is the whole point of the conception. And we go back to something that Ulysses sang early on in the first act. So it sort of undercuts, I think, the whole point of this of this opera, which is a trajectory of a man's growth from a certain innocence to a certain level of maturity. So that's another problem with the cast recording, I think. In recent years, revivals have used the original ending, and of course we await a full-fledged recording of this piece that will utilize the original ending as well, so people will have an opportunity to hear it, because it's just not available at this point.
Well, I recently spoke to Ian Marshall Fisher for this program. He created and runs a remarkable organization called Lost Musicals, and he is a great advocate of the Golden Apple. And I asked him, well, is it possible to revive this work? He said that he did do this, but he felt that there was a problem with the Golden Apple today, in that the audience of today that would be going to the theater for that kind of entertainment would find it too sophisticated, that it would be above their heads, and that it might be difficult to really bring it back today successfully. But I think it would be a tremendous hit today. What do you think?
Well, I have a couple of responses to that. One thing is, I was thinking about this recently about Golden Apple, is that I think it's a great school show. There are so many conservatories of music and colleges that put on operas. It makes real demands on the singer, so you need to have operatic training. But it also has a lot of characters, It's a lot of fun, and it's a great piece, and I think it would be a great school show. So I don't know why it hasn't really caught on with colleges and conservatories. It's interesting, too, getting back to the vocal writing. The vocal writing is pretty operatic. I would make a distinction somewhat with some of the pieces of Mark Blitzstein's. Now, some of Mark Blitzstein's work also call for operatic voices, but some, like his earlier works like Cradle Will Rock and No for an Answer, call for singing actors. There's always this kind of, you know, fine line with some of these stage works, American stage works, that make contact with the musical comedy tradition, but in different ways, in distinct ways. Golden Apple, I think, is fully operatic in terms of what it needs with voices. So you wouldn't have the voices would be able to project in larger houses. I think it could certainly be done in opera houses. I mean, any opera houses today, they do Showboat, and they do a little night music and so forth. I mean, Golden Apple is more operatic than either of those, for instance. So I don't see it being I see it being perfectly suitable for opera houses. One thing that I would say that's interesting about this comment about it being very sophisticated, I don't think you need to know the Odyssey and the Iliad to enjoy this opera, but it certainly enhances our understanding of it. I mean, the idea of taking these great mythic stories and taking the figures of Circe and Calypso and the Trojan War and so forth, and Helen and Menelaus and so forth, and re-envisioning them to make a comment about modernity and the growth of and developments in the 20th century from a primarily agrarian rural society to an industrial modern society, to conflate these two mythic ideas together was so brilliant and so ingenious, and that it requires, I think, a certain feel for both developments. It takes place between 1900 and 1910, which is a pivotal time in the development of industrial societies, and to see how Ulysses' trip of 10 years plays out against this development is a fascinating one. But I think it really enhances your appreciation for it if you have some feeling for the original stories, much as Frankie and Johnny draws on legend, and the ballet ballads, Susanna, from the biblical story of Susanna, and Davy Crockett. All of these works that draw on legend and myth require, I think, a certain familiarity with the myth for one to get the full flavor of and the full meaning of the piece. So that's one of the challenges of some of these works.
Well, I agree entirely, but even then, there are many elements, I feel, in The Golden Apple particularly, which I think are very immediately appealing just for what they are. Now, take Lazy Afternoon. Well, one of the most famous, let's call it, songs written. Do you know, I think that there are over 160, 170 recordings made of that. Now, that's been enormously popular. I know, of course, that I'm talking about it being played, sung out of context. I think very few people who know the work, and not so many who've performed it, are aware of its origins in The Golden Apple. But I'm only illustrating the fact that there's an element there that stands up on its own feet, regardless of any of the contexts around it. But as I say, I think that maybe even more than 170 recordings. It's quite extraordinary.
Oh, my goodness. That's amazing. Well, to get back to this idea about some context, we all know Lazy Afternoon, or many of us know Lazy Afternoon, but to take it into its dramatic context, it's an incredibly sensuous, very, very sensuous in both its lyric and its music. It's cast in the Dorian scale, so it also has a certain antique quality about it. Well, the combination of this amazing seductive quality combined with the antique quality, isn't that marvelous for a contemporary song that Helen, the goddess of love, would sing? And Helen is well known of a figure to everyone that I think you can get that. You could get that this is not only a beautiful song, you could see it on different levels. You could see it as a beautiful song and beautiful seductive song, but sung by the goddess of love in a dramatic context gives it, I think, an extra quality that's really quite marvelous.
And for me, it's almost a quality of ambiguity and ambivalence. I find a great sadness, maybe that's not the right word, a melancholy, a longing in this music that has a melancholy overtone to it. I find it almost dreamlike. The whole sound world is evocative in such a haunting way.
It's in the orchestration, and it's in the harmony as well. And that's an interesting aspect of Moross, is that these tunes very often are so singable and tuneful. But at the same time, you get these very, very interesting harmonies underneath that create a very distinctive atmosphere. And I would say that that's something he does share with Mark Blitzstein, who's a contemporary and also a master of stage works at the time. They both were able to write wonderfully tuneful melodies, but at the same time cast them in a harmonic context that was alluring and interesting, and gave maybe some more sophisticated listeners something more to listen to than just the beautiful melody.
Yes, and always with Moross, certainly in his stage works, he's setting the words. Perhaps setting is not the right word for me to use now. He's expressing the words, not just the meaning of the words, but the sound of the words, the colour of the words, the expression in the words. Now, I think that's one reason why his collaboration with John La Touche was so successful, because La Touche himself was a very poetically expressive writer. It seems to me that in John La Touche, Jerome Moross found almost his ideal collaborator.
Well, I would love to have the opportunity to talk a little bit about Moross and La Touche as a combination, as a collaboration, because I think it's a great collaboration, like Strauss and Hofmannsthal or Mozart and De Ponte, because I think it was really a wonderful meeting of two minds and two spirits that produced something very, very special in their collaboration. They both had rather similar backgrounds, and they also had tremendous admiration for each other's work. La Touche had, a lot of musical friends. He was very good friends with Virgil Thompson and Aaron Copland, had some musical background himself, and appreciated good music. And Moross, very much like Vernon Duke, who worked with La Touche about this time, and Duke Ellington, and later Douglas Moore and Leonard Bernstein, all appreciated the fact that La Touche was an extraordinary lyricist for the musical stage, and the most sophisticated musical minds working on Broadway wanted to work with him. And that was because his lyrics are extremely poetic. You could just look at Lazy Afternoon and the words Lazy Afternoon as evidence of that. And yet he also knew how to structure a piece of work and create comedy and to create laughs in his lyrics. So he was really a very, very special lyricist. And so there was a lot of mutual respect and admiration there. They also seemed to have enjoyed each other's company quite a lot. La Touche had a large coterie of friends. He was extremely popular, knew everyone in the New York world, and was a great social host, and had a lot of famous literary friends like Tennessee Williams and Capote and the poet Frank O'Hara and so forth. And he was just a charming individual to be around and so forth. And he and Moross enjoyed each other's company quite a lot when he was seeing, when he and Kenward Elmsley, who became his companion and lover for a period of time towards the end of his life, they would often play bridge with Moross and his wife and be up till, 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning playing cards. And they enjoyed each other's company enormously. All that said, La Touche was a difficult collaborator because he had a lot of irons in the fire, was going at full tilt all the time, probably drank too much. It was somewhat reminiscent of the collaboration of Richard Rodgers and Lorenz Hart a bit. There's some interesting letters from Douglas Moore when they were working on Ballad of Baby Doe, which is, one of America's most enduring operas, pleading with him to get material done. And that was, I think, a common experience for a lot of musicians working with La Touche, was just to kind of sit him down and get him to produce the work that was needed to be produced. So that put some strain on all his collaborations. And I think after Golden Apple, they were set to maybe take a little break from each other, perhaps. It's not quite clear. But I have little doubt that they would have come together and work on another project. We have to remember La Touche died in 1956, just a couple of years after the opening of the Golden Apple. And so there was really no opportunity. They were already talking about new projects to work on. So I think they would have continued, like, as I said, to give some exalted, lofty model, Strauss and Hoffmannsthal. Now, of course, Moross went on and found some excellent lyricists to work later with, including the poet John Hollander, and that on Underworld. And that gives you an idea of what Moross was expecting from his poetic collaborators. He did not want a Tin Pan Alley wordsmith. I mean, he wanted a poet to work with. He wanted a serious poet to work with. And so he worked with John Hollander on Underworld and with Edward Eger on Gentlemen Be Seated. So he had quite high standards for the literary people that he wanted to associate himself with.
Yes, that's so important. He was a man, Jerome Moross, of very high standards culturally. And, well, you have enlightened us very importantly as to how and why it is that Moross's music for the stage is so very strongly powerful and gripping, as you've described very clearly to us, because of the combination of his formal mastery, his remarkable imagination in orchestration, and this wonderful ability, this wonderful inspiration to set words. So, Howard Pollack, thank you very much indeed for giving us your invaluable expertise for our Jerome Moross centenary celebration.
Thank you, John. Bye-bye.